So the first book I'll mention is A Ghost in the Throat by Dhiríni Gréifa. This is an amazing, her first foray into prose fiction. It's not a novel, it's a personal memoir, and it's about her life as a mother, as, you know, having children and breastfeeding, and an obsession she has with the poet Evelyn Dubh Ní Chonaill, who wrote the amazing poem, The Lament for Art O'Leary. And this was back in 1773. And Dhiríni then goes on a kind of literary journey to try and find out what caused her to write that poem, because her husband was murdered. And in the poem, she bends down and drinks handfuls of his blood. So it's a very, very dramatic poem. And she discovers all sorts of things about the poet, about her life and about her relationship to Ireland, and it's absolutely fabulous, while at the same time being a really, really honest account of her own life, her struggles as a poet, and the tragedy she has in her own life in relation to the birth of her daughter. So it's very honest, but it's beautifully written, it's poignant, and I would highly recommend it. So that's one. So then if we do something completely different, this is An Irish Nature Year, and this is a great book because you can just pick it up every day and read a little paragraph about what's going on in the world, in Ireland, in nature. So you think, oh, it's a dull November day, but it's not, because something is happening that Jane has observed. I would like to have seen it with more illustrations, because the illustrations, though they're lovely, they're in black and white, and you'd love the colour illustrations all the way through, but maybe that was a bit too expensive. But it's a beautiful book. This book was long listed for the Dublin Literary Prize. It's called Anuradha Roy's All the Lives We Never Lived. And I'm just going to read the opening, because this is what attracted me to it. In my childhood, I was known as the boy whose mother had run off with an Englishman. The man was in fact German, but in small town India in those days, all white foreigners were largely thought of as British. This unconcern for accuracy annoyed my scholarly father, even in circumstances as dire as losing his wife to another man. So it's a brilliant journey of this boy, Mishkin, and his rebellious, as it says in the back, freedom-seeking mother. It goes from India to Dutch-held Bali. It talks about love, loss, tragedy. It's got everything. It's a real, almost like, you know, the old-fashioned saga, but it's beautifully written, and it is a book that once you pick it up, you're totally immersed in until you get to the last page. So I would highly recommend that one. Donal Ryan, probably everybody knows about Donal Ryan's latest book, but I read it when I was away, and I just wanted to cry practically all the way through it. Not for sadness, but just because this is a person writing with such compassion for ordinary people, and for the tragedy that sometimes affects ordinary lives. So it's about the loss of a daughter, and it's the extraordinary story of a family devastated by a sudden disappearance and transformed by a miraculous return. So the daughter, 20-year-old Moll Gladney, leaves her family home, just disappears and is never heard of. And, well, she is heard of again, but that what happens to the family is that you can imagine that devastating loss of not knowing where your daughter is, just so horrible. But then when she comes back, it is about, you know, anger, it's about forgiveness, it's about compassion, and it's about miracles. And it is written with such beauty, and as I say, I'm repeating the word compassion, because Donal has this ability to not to judge. So you get the whole picture, and at the end of it, you're left with this beautiful world. Just simply beautiful. And there's lots about nature in it as well, which is another reason I really enjoyed it. During COVID times, we are faced with all these huge restrictions, and we are forced to spend a lot of time indoors, we're forced to spend a lot of time behind masks, we're forced to spend a lot of time on our own. And poetry seems to me, and maybe it's just because I'm a poet, but poetry seems to me something that we can have inside ourselves when we're walking, when we can't sleep, when we're anxious about COVID and about what the future holds for us. And Ted Hughes wrote this book, or edited and introduced this book by heart. It's 101 Poems to Remember. And in the book, he revisits lots of poems we all know, but he explains in the introduction how to memorize a poem. And the reason I love it is that when you learn a poem, you literally take it into your heart. So therefore, when you're anxious, you can reflect on that poem, or that poem can come up completely intact and take you away from the immediate anxiety of the world that is filled with uncertainty. So it's a small little book. You can carry it around with you if you're going for your walks, but it teaches you the security of words. So another book that I mentioned biographies. This is a fabulous biography. It's The Life and Times of Frédéric Chopin by Alan Walker. It's, even if you never like music, if you don't like music, which most people do like music, but even if you don't like classical music, this is a fascinating study of how Chopin became what he is, and how it, I think Alan Walker says in the book that somewhere in the world, all the time, someone is either listening to or playing Chopin, because he's so popular. This is a person who wrote romantic music that was shunned by his peers when he was alive, but it also explores his world. So we're going into Poland, we're going into all the places that he lived, and his relationship, and his whole life, which is just fascinating. It has a whole section on Chopin and the keyboard, which is really interesting if you play the piano, but you could gloss over that if you don't. He also tells a story of Schumann, which I didn't know, who the fourth finger when you play the piano is the weakest. And Schumann developed a little machine to exercise his fourth finger to make it stronger. But what he did instead was damage his hand, so he couldn't play in concerts any longer. So that was really sad. So I'm looking forward then to, these are ones I've read, obviously, and I'm looking forward to reading The Art of Falling by Danielle McLaughlin. Danielle, this is her first novel, but she was shortlisted for the Kate O'Brien Award with Dinosaurs and Other Planets. She is a wonderful writer, and I'm really looking forward to that. Interesting for someone to move from the short story genre to a first novel. And the other book that I'm really looking forward to, I don't have it yet, is Maggie O'Farrell, who, I really love Maggie O'Farrell's books. Her latest one, Hamlet, was just simply stunning. It's about Shakespeare's kind of fictional look at Shakespeare's son, Hamlet. And it actually is very relevant for today, because it talks about the plague, and of course we've got COVID. But she has written her first, I just make sure I get the right name right. She's written her first book for children. It's for five-year-olds, and it's called Where Snow Angels Go. So it's for 5+, and it's apparently beautifully illustrated. But as I love children's books, I would put that on my Christmas list for definite.